Hello, my friends. I will present to you today 8 lessons that I have learned from my favorite guitar heroes. And if you're like me and you're on YouTube all the time, then maybe you've seen some of these clips, but I bet you haven't seen all of them. And I think these messages are the most important and all-encompassing messages that we as guitar players should really take to heart. This covers the gambit from technique to philosophy to X factors that you may not have considered before. So, without further ado, I'm going to show you 8 of the most important lessons that I've learned from awesome guitar players. So this first topic is about finding your own voice on the instrument, and it's really a testament to my end game. My goal as a musician is to be able to speak exactly from what's my mind, make that happen on the frets, and this is an ongoing process that few have mastered, and it's definitely something that I'm going to work on until the day I depart from this universe, but it's probably the most important message that I can think of when I am teaching using my guitar courses or in my YouTube videos. I am always conscious of how the information applies to the person receiving it. I don't want to ever create clones of myself, my own technique, or any other guitar players, which is why I think finding your own voice on the instrument is paramount and the most important thing. So, without further ado, here's Joe Satriani talking to Steve Vai about the purity of the music inside you and how to access it.
What it's really all about to be a musician, what it really means to embrace improvisation as a way of musical life. And it sounds easy because people think when you improvise, you're just making stuff up.
Yeah.
But it's deeper than that. It's not repeating stuff that you've learned that you know works with your friends, on stage, which is really hard to give up.
Yeah.
Like if I do this Jimmy Page lick, people not only will think I'm cool, but they'll get a smile on their face and they'll have a good time. So you're telling me I got to get rid of that lick?
Yeah.
And he's like, yes, shed everything. Get to the purity of the musical expression that is coming from inside of you. And even just saying that out loud seemed like, I don't know about that. That sounds funky to me, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, interesting. Yeah.
But behind that was, you have to know everything cold.
Yeah.
And if you don't know the next note you're playing, then don't play a note. That was the whole thing.
Next topic I have for you is on playing with dynamics. And this is a really neat clip. This is actually John Mayer and my old private instructor, who was also John Mayer's instructor while he was at Berklee College of Music, Tomo Fujita. And essentially they're having a conversation about playing with dynamics and not peaking too early with your vocabulary. So this clip starts off with my old teacher taking his time, really taking a nice, slow, dynamic approach to a blues solo. And then afterwards, John explains how that's important. And this applies much more than just to blues guitar playing, but to music in general. The greater dynamic sense you have when you're a guitar player, whether you're metal, funk, jazz, R&B, whatever, then you will be a more effective conveyor of information from your guitar to the listener. Enjoy the clip.
And just because it's so great to hear this man play, Tomo, take your time like you've never taken your time and see if anybody walks out because they're bored. Ceiling. All things have a dynamic ceiling, and you never want people to see it. It's almost like in the spy movies when you put the spray on the lathe. You never want to show people where you're your top is. And then you're just working down. Then you have two more choruses. Like, if you're ever playing and you go like this, you're like, oh, you need another one? You want another one? Oh. It's all vocabulary, and I don't want to get into that. Well, B.B. King could kick so-and-so's ass with one note. It's less to do with that and more to do with how you put it in a lyrical. That, Tomo played a lyrical solo that had everybody going, talk to me, talk to me, talk to me, talk to me. And when it gets too sort of over-dynamic too fast, then it just cracks. It's like a personality in somebody. You go, I got to take a walk.
This next clip is from an interview that I got to do with Paul Reed Smith. And I know what you're thinking, Paul Reed Smith isn't like a crazy guitar hero. Well, he makes some of the greatest guitars ever made, so I think he knows a thing or two about music. And this is actually a really vital lesson for those of you who maybe haven't studied in a more academic environment when it comes to music. There are three elements of music that we should always be considering when we create music, again, no matter what genre or style we prefer, or what our instrument is for that matter. So here is three aspects of music that Paul Reed Smith believes are the most important.
Rhythm, harmony, and melody.
Oh, okay.
And if people learn rhythm, and they learn melody, and they learn harmony, they work. If you have somebody who knows melody and harmony, but doesn't have good rhythm, they don't work.
No.
But if you have somebody with good rhythm and good harmony, they probably work. If they have good rhythm and good melody, they probably work. But if they don't have rhythm, dead. No working. Dada. Gone.
I agree.
And so really good musicians often are drummers. I mean, it's rumored that Carlos Santana and Eddie Van Halen's both great drummers.
In the next clip, we hear about limiting yourself in order to become a greater guitar player. This means confining yourself, restricting yourself to certain limitations in order to spawn creativity and also be able to prevail in any situation you find yourself in. This lesson was taught to me by Zach Wilde. He frames it in the sense of limiting yourself to a pentatonic scale and trying to sound original and unique. It's kind of the less is more approach, where if you have less to work with, you can do more when you have more. This lesson is presented to us by Zach Wilde.
I'll make everything based off of pentatonic scales. Like all my solos, everything I'm gonna do, whether it's Miracle Man, anything like that, Crazy Babies, any of the solos that we did on those records. And it was just, majority of it was just all pentatonic scales. Just like to force myself to have to be creative with, you only have X amount of crayons, let's see what you can do. Nothing but not, I mean, you really look at those Hendrix albums and everything, you know, everybody would always say, well, imagine if Jimmy had all this stuff nowadays, Pro Tools and everything. Imagine what those records would have sounded like. I said, yeah, probably garbage. They wouldn't have sounded as brilliant and as insanely innovative as they were because they had really not much to work with. It forces you to use your noggin and actually, let's try a little bit of this and try a little bit of that and see what we can make with very limited amount of stuff.
This clip is about originality, and not necessarily originality in the sense of finding your own voice on the guitar, like I mentioned with that Joe Satriani clip. This is more about standing out in an age where we are overwhelmed with, you know, YouTube and the internet in general. It's harder than ever to stick out as a musician. So how do you do that? Well, the answer may surprise you. Here's Guthrie Govan talking about originality and standing out from the crowd.
I'm assuming it's always been considered difficult to be original. I think you can go to any point in musical history and the bulk of people would assume all the good stuff's already been written, all the interesting musical identities have already happened. I don't think this is a more challenging time than ever before. If anything, I think it's a more fertile time than ever before because you can find all this obscure, thought-provoking, stimulating playing on the internet. An artist doesn't need to get a record company behind him to get his music out there. I think there's a huge pool of ideas, like a bigger resource of inspiration now than ever before.
In the next clip, we hear about the most important element of practice. And it's one word, and it was told to me by a good friend of mine, Nick Johnston. Let's hear what Nick thinks about the guitar and what it takes to reach our maximum potential.
This is a brutally difficult instrument with no shortcuts. And you just have to be patient. I know everybody wants to be awesome overnight and be able to post awesome Instagram videos and stuff. But the reality is, like, that's not important.
Okay.
Time and energy and years and studying and patience. I mean, that's really what it comes down to.
This next clip is about fundamentals and technique and ergonomic maintenance. the nuts and bolts, the meat and potatoes, the boring side of guitar. However, this could be one of the most underrated lessons of this video today. I believe that you must be a student of all elements and all aspects of your instrument, and that means maintenance, that means ergonomics, how you hold the guitar, the way your strap height is, your actual technique. Not that there's one proper way to pick the guitar, but being conscious of different approaches. You should be open-minded and be seeking out the absolute best way to play your instrument. Let's hear what Eric Johnson has to say about this.
One of the things that makes your hands sore are the repetitive motion of the same. Like if you got a scale or a lick or something and you keep practicing the same thing over and over with the same, that's going to really make it sore a lot quicker. So if you try different stuff to where you're not using the same position, the same muscle memory all the time, I think that helps a lot. I know that when I'm working on like I have a song on the new record called Fat Daddy, which is kind of this weird kind of thing I have to do, and I know if I'm at home and I haven't played it for a few weeks, and it's kind of difficult for me to play that song, so I'll sit there and practice it for 2 hours, my hand will really hurt because I'm doing that same thing over and over. But if I mix it up with other stuff, and also, I know it's probably a cool look to wear your strap really low, but it's really, really bad on your wrist. Like if you're trying to do like a lot of interesting voicings, it really works better to wear your strap up high so you look more like Mr. Rogers.
The final clip of this video addresses the element of musicianship and performance. It's my opinion that this person who will be speaking in this clip is among one of the greatest performers of all time regarding his execution as well as the music he puts out into the world and his overall attitude. This is a very important lesson for those of you who have aspirations of being a live performer or just being a competent musician, being able to play for your friends or your family, whatever. This mindset is a tool to help us measure our progress as well as define what our goals are and what our music can do for us in the real world. And this message is brought to us by Mr. John Petrucci.
I mean, there's some things that just, they kind of come natural because, you know, maybe they sound like they're difficult, but it's just the way that I develop my style that they're fairly easy to play. And there's other things that just are difficult.
Sure.
And if you don't maintain your chops and your technique, you're not going to be able to do it. Mm. And I always talk about this. You know, it's one thing to be able to do something in the privacy of your at-home studio or wherever you practice, yeah, and there's nobody watching you.
Yeah, low volume.
Low volume, yeah, and yeah, you're all comfortable and relaxed, and you have a cup of coffee. And it's another thing when you're in performance mode.
Right.
You know, when you're up there and there's the adrenaline and there's people in front of you and lights hitting you and sound.
Huge volume.
You yeah know, and you get one shot and that's it. That kind of separates the professionals, I think, because that's when you really have to deliver the goods. You have people that come to a show expecting to see something, to be entertained, and they're there because they want to see you play the songs, and you really got to deliver.
Sure.
And so, you know, things come into play like stamina, control, breathing.
Right, okay.
Not just technique, but how to make that technique shine in the best way, because the littlest thing could mess you up.
So there you have it, guys. 8 of the most important messages, lessons that I've learned from my favorite guitar players. Obviously, those aren't all my favorite guitar players, and those aren't all the things that I've learned in my time here on this planet, but I can assure you, I spent a lot of time looking through different clips and trying to consolidate all my thoughts on what is the most important things, that is, about playing guitar, and I'm always trying to be a better educator, and I think the best way to do that is to be educated by people who are better and smarter and more experienced than you are. The best part about this is knowledge is free for everybody. It's about what you do with it that reveals your path as a musician. I hope this was a fun and helpful video for you guys, and until next time, keep shredding.